Hello students, welcome to the session. I am Mr. M.H. Mota, Assistant Professor, Department of Civil Engineering. This session is on arches. The outcome of this session. At the end of this session, you will be in a position to understand and explain various types of arches. Let's start learning. So arches. An arch may be defined as mechanical arrangement of wedge-shaped blocks of stones or bricks mutually supporting each other and supported at the end by piers or abutments like lintels. So they are very similar to the lintels, but the only difference is the shape. Sometimes arches are even very similar to lintels like flat arches, but in most of the cases you will find that arch is a certain circular kind of element which is used to support the construction above an opening. It generally consists of small wedge-shaped units which are joined together by mortar. Mortar is used to hold these all blocks interlinked and together. They are acting as a binding material and they bind two different units placed very next to each other. The function of an arch is to carry the weight of a structure above the opening. As we have learned in case of lintel, that every opening constructed in a building may not span from the bottom to the top of the structure. Rather, they have a certain limited height, particularly in case of doors, windows, etc. And one need to construct a certain amount of wall or any structural part or structural element above it to enclose the space. So the arch is very much like similar to lintel, used to carry the weight of the structure above the opening. Because of their shape, the blocks support each other by mutual pressure of their own weight, and the structure remains in position by the resistance from the support. So they are different in acting like an arches. However, arches made of steel and RCC are built in a single unit, unlike whatever we have discussed in above section, and they are used to bridge the construction, used for bridge construction in particular. Arches are constructed where the loads are very heavy, the span is more, and strong abutments or support is available, and special architectural appearance is required. Generally, arches are constructed to have a very good elemental appearance. An arch is pure compression form. It can span a large area by resolving forces into compressive stresses and in turn eliminating the tensile stresses. Lintels are such part where along with the compression stresses, even tensile stresses exist. But in arch, the tensile stresses are completely eliminated and whole arch acts as a pure compression structural member. This is sometimes referred as arch action. As the forces in arch are carried to the ground, the arch will push outward at the base, and this particular process or the action is called thrust. As the rise or height of arch decreases, the outward thrust increases as it is resulting from the center, and as you go outward, that thrust is increasing. In order to maintain the arch action and prevent the arch from collapsing, the thrust needs to be restrained either with internalities or external bracing such as abutment. All these structural elements we will learn in detail in next sessions. So now let's try to understand different technical terms used in arches. First is intrados. Intrados is nothing but the internal or inner curve of the arch. The figure shows the intrados. It is, in simple words, you can say that the bottom of an arch or the surface of the bottom of the arch is nothing but the intrados, soffit, the inner surface of the arch. Sometimes the term intrados and soffit are treated as synonymous. extrados or back is the external curve of an arch. Then the wowzers, the wedge-shaped units forming the course of an arch is called wowzers. The figure shows the different wedge-shaped blocks which are called as an wowzers. Then the skew back, the inclined or splayed surface of an abutment is skew back. It is prepared to receive the arch and form it, spring the arch. The figure shows skew back too. Next term is springer. The first wowzer at springing level on either side of an arch is called springer, or it is the first unit of the arch which is in contact with the skew back is the springer. Next is the crown. The highest point of an extrados is crown. Centrally placed stone in case of arch is called keystone, and the highest point of that is called the crown. Key, the wedge-shaped unit at the crown or an arch is keystone, as explained earlier. It is sometimes made prominent by making it of a larger section and projecting it below and above the outline of an arch. This is the major stone or the major unit which is responsible for the overall stability of the arch. If the keystone fails, the whole arch will collapse. Next is the abutment. Abutments are the end support of an arch, while pier are the intermediate support of an arcade. Arcade is nothing but a series of an arch, and in that series of an arch, piers are the intermediate supports, while the abutments are the end supports. Very similar kind of terminology is even used in bridge engineering, where the abutment and piers are very common terms used. Next is the springing point. The point from which the curve of an arch springs or start is called springing point. It is the starting point of an arch or the curve of an arch. Springing line. It is an imaginary horizontal line joining two springing points. It is called springing line. So you can say that if you connect the soffit end points with an imaginary horizontal line, it will form the springing line as such. Then the span. Span is the clear horizontal distance between the supports. It can be the distance between two consecutive piers or the piers and abutments which are very next to each other. This is called as a span of an arch. Rise. Rise is the clear vertical distance between the highest point on the intrados and the springing line. Please remember, this rise is a clear vertical distance between the highest point on intrados. So it is internal surface. So it is a distance between the internal soffit highest point or the base of a crown and the springing line. Center. The geometric center of the curve of an arch is called as a center. In arches, there can be the arches which may have a one center or more than one center. Even the number of centers in case of arch can be in a range of 5 to 7 in many cases. This depends on the expected shape of the arch. Ring. Ring is the circular course forming the arch is called a ring. Then depth or height, the perpendicular distance between the intrados and extrados is called depth or height. This may be uniform throughout the arch or may be varying. It depends once again on the type of arch. The total depth or height might be more in case of crown. It might be similar or it might be varying as explained earlier. Spandrel is the irregular triangular shape formed between the extrados and the horizontal line drawn tangent to the crown. So generally the horizontal line drawn tangent might be the line, and in between that line and the surface formed as an extra dose may form a certain irregular triangular shape. That shape is called spandrel. Then haunch. Haunch is the lower half portion of the arch between the crown and the skew back. And arcade. Arcade is the arrow of arches supporting a wall above and being supported by the piers. Now let's try to understand the classification of an arches. The classification of arches can be done according to shape of an arch, number of centers made to form an arch, and material and workmanship used to construct the particular arch as such. In this session, we will try to understand the classification based on shape and based on number of centers. We will discuss the material and workmanship classification in another session. Even the classification can be done according to the material of the construction. So according to the shape of arch, the arch can be a flat arch, segmental arch, semicircular arch, horseshoe arch, pointed arch or Gothic arch, then Venetian arch, Florentine arch, relieving arch, steeled arch, semi-elliptical arch. So we will start this particular classification from understanding the flat arch. As name itself suggests, flat arch has an intrados as a plane or flat surface. So the intrados is apparently flat, but it is given a slight rise of a camber of about 10 to 15 mm per meter width of an opening to allow for a small settlement. This settlement can occur after the construction when we remove the supporting structure for such arches. However, the extrados is kept horizontal or flat. The flat arches are used only for light loads and up to a span of 1.5 meter. The figure in the particular is shown the flat arch. Next is segmental arch. This is a common type of arch used for building in which the intrados and extrados each form a certain small segment of a circle. The center of arch lies below the springing line in this case. The thrust transferred to the abutment is in an inclined direction. Next is pointed arch, which is even called as a Gothic arch. It consists of two arches of circular shape meeting at an apex. The triangle form may be equilateral or isosceles. In the latter case, it is even known as a lancet or lancet arch. Next is Venetian arch. This is another form of a pointed arch which has a deeper depth at crown than at springing. It has four centers all located on the springing line. The figure in this slide shows the examples of Venetian arch, where you will find that the overall depth is varying. It is less at the supports or at the sides of an arch, while at center it is continuously increasing. It once again are meeting at a center as a pointed arch. Next is Florentine arch. This is a similar to Venetian arch, except that the intrados is semicircular. An arch has got three centers, all located on the springing line. Here the intrados or soffit is made semicircular, while the extrados has got two different centers, and because of that they have formed a pointed meeting at the crown. Next is relieving arch. This arch is constructed either on a flat arch or on a wooden lintel to provide a greater strength. So relieving arch has got some different kind of construction methodology. Generally in arch you will find that below soffit no construction is done. But in case of relieving arch you will find that the supporting construction even for the arch remains at its place. The ends of the relieving arch should be carried sufficiently into the abutment. The relieving arch makes it possible to replace the decayed lintel later because of the arch action. The stability of such construction is much more than a common lintel. So in case of the expected removal, we can replace it and the structure still able to survive because of the arch action. The relieving arch are shown in the figures on this slide. In first case, it is a relieving arch made up of bricks, while in second case, the relieving arch is made up of stone units or the bricks, and they are even supported with the help of a certain wooden lintel. Next is steel arch. It consists of a semicircular arch with two vertical portions at the springing. The center of the arch lies on the horizontal line passing the tops of the vertical portion. The figure shows such steel arches. Next is semi-elliptical arch. This type of arch has the shape of semi-ellipse and may have either three centers or five centers, as shown in the figure. Now, next classification is based on the number of the centers. So, based on the number of the centers, the arches may be classified as one-centered arch, two-centered arch, three-centered arch, four-centered arch, or five-centered arch. In few very rare cases, even the seven-centered arch is possible. So, one-centered arch, a segmental arch, a semicircular arch, flat arch, or horseshoe arch and stilted arches comes under this category. Sometimes, a perfectly circular arch known as bullseye arch is provided for circular windows. The figure shows the one-centered arch where the everything, the intrados as well as the extrados surface is formed by a certain circular segment which is having a single center. Next is two-centered arch. The pointed arch comes under this category. The semi-elliptical arch and Florentine arch comes even under this category. The figure shows the different possibilities of the two-centered arches where these two centers may lie below the springing line or on the springing line. Again, the different possibilities are there where these centers can lie on the springing line. They can lie in between the two supports or abutments. They even can lie exactly at the meeting of the springing line with the abutment, or they even may be beyond this kind of limit. So every type of two-centered arch is used to form a different shape. But once again, please remember that two-centered arches are forming the pointed arches. Next is the three-centered arches. The elliptical arches comes under this category where we have three different centers of the arch. The two centers in the adjoining figure are lying on the springing line, while one center is lying below the springing line. The green line shows the possible part of an arch developed with the help of a segment drawn with the higher amount of radius, and the point where this line meets the springing line, from there another part or the another segment can be drawn to form a three-centered arch. Four-centered arch. As name suggests, it has a four centers. Venetian arch is typical example of this type. The another example as shown in figure is Tudor arch. So these are the four-centered arches where the whole part is formed by using four different centers which are forming the segments to construct or to form an overall arch section. Next is five-centered arch. This arch is having a five centers gives a very good semi-elliptical shape. The figure shows the five different possible centers which are there to form such five-centered arch. These are very difficult to construct, as the shape of this arch is to be formed by using five different centers. Even the classification is based on the material and workmanship. On the basis of that, arches may be classified as the stone arches, brick arches, concrete arches. Stone arches are further divided as rubble arch and ashlar arch. We have already gone through the different kinds of stone masonries. Based on that line, the arches can be constructed as a rubble arch or ashlar arch. In case of brick arches, the arches are constructed using the bricks. The further brick arches are classified as rough arch, axed or rough cut arch, gauged arch and purpose made brick arch. And the last is the concrete arch. These concrete arch can be constructed as using a different concrete blocks, or it can be a monolithic arch. So these are the references to form this particular presentation. So that's it for this session. Let's meet in the next session to know more about an arches. And thank you. And don't forget to like, comment and subscribe. Thank you.